your attention to the Word of God today. I'm not going to preach very long today because I don't think it's going to take very long for the Lord to get through with me and to go ahead and move in this service like He wants to. And this is going to be a ministry of exhortation today. Sometimes there are ministries of conviction. Sometimes there are ministries of reproof. Sometimes there's ministry of prophecy. But this is a ministry of exhortation. I want to exhort this congregation to good works. We have a good congregation. We have a great God. And there's no reason that we should not go forth to do good works. Can somebody say amen? Amen. Romans chapter 8, verse 18. We will read only one scripture today from the King James Version. It says, "For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." Everybody say, "shall be."
Shall be.
Means that it's going to happen. Shall be revealed in us. It tells us plainly. And you know, I don't know. It sounds like a country boy that's saying this. You know, some scriptures just sound like they would, you know, that somebody out in the country wrote this. Coach, this is for I reckon. For I reckon the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be. That means going to happen. It's going to be revealed in us. Maybe somebody here today, you're just a late bloomer. You're 45, 55, 65 years old or counting. And you have yet to find your or fulfill your potential in the kingdom. Today is your day. This is not the seventh time around. That was last week. This is the first day of a brand new day. This is my time. This is my opportunity. This is where I get on board. This is where I go for to do good works. So I want to preach on the subject. It's a very unusual title. You'll understand it better by and by. It's simply this: the last time I checked. The last time I checked. People often walk up to me, Coach, and say, "How you doing?" I said, "I'm doing pretty good the last time I checked." People say, how's your wife and kids? I said, "Well, they're doing pretty good last time I checked." How's your walk with God? You fill in the blank. How's your relationship with God? How's that overcoming thing working out for you? Pretty good? Pretty bad? Are you pretty powerful or are you pretty powerless? I don't know. But you're only as good as the last time you checked. For you people in the church here that drive a car, most everybody does, you don't just put oil in your car one time and drive your car for 250,000 miles without ever checking the oil again. First of all, it's impossible to do that. Because somewhere along the way on your journey of a quarter of a million miles, you're going to run out of oil. I don't care if your car doesn't even use any oil. It will not go that far without needing the oil checked. Now, I will tell you this. Life has a way of pulling the spiritual dipstick on you and me every day. I don't know if you even got what I said. But something or someone in particular is going to come along and pull your spiritual dipstick. And they're going to check to see if you got any oil left at all. And it's only going to be as good as the last time I checked. Amen? Now that you're looking at me so funny and acting like, what in the world is this going to be? It ain't going to be nothing. That's all right. Hang out for a minute. We'll see. I love you. Let's pray the blessings of the Lord. Jesus, we need you today. We ask that you would walk down these aisles. Speak to our hearts and our lives. Lord, go before us and make ways where there seem to be no way. Lord, we're going to be careful to give you the glory and the honor and the praise in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. God bless you as you are seated today. Thank you. Brother, Sister Figueroa, I have Brother Figueroa's folks here from El Salvador. We're very glad that you are here. God bless you. It's been said already. If there's a prize given to the one who came the furthest, you are the prize winner today. The second runner-up, Sister Angie, did you leave Columbus, Ohio this morning to get to church today? Well, bless your heart. I'm going to buy you a Slurpee. Angie came all the way from Columbus, Ohio to be in service with us today. Was it cooler in Columbus? It was. I can see you fanning back there right now. The last time I checked, Joe and Brittany have guests with them today. Joe, God bless you. Gentlemen, thank you for being here. I'm so glad you're here. You make yourself at home. And if Joe don't treat you right, just see me, okay? I'll take care of that. Is there anything else? I'm kind of wondering if I kind of feel like I'm missing something. Or maybe I'm missing somebody that I need to acknowledge today. Oh, there are three people here, special people that I want to acknowledge before I preach today. The Williams brothers are here today. And it was just a week or so ago that we talked about our lives are the only Bible that some people will read. Does anybody remember that cliche that was thrown out in the service? Anybody remember that? Just Lisa, were you the only one listening, Lisa? That your life might be the only Bible. And you know, some people in our congregation, they're leaders and they lead in ways that they don't even know. They lead with the words they say, Brother Knight, or maybe the way they worship, or maybe even the way that they have a strong fashion sense, or they have a strong sense of fashion. And they lead others by even the way they present themselves. Well, today the Williams brothers are coming right now. Thank you very much. Would you come? Come on, Brother Shane. Yeah, come on. Come on. Would you give a round of applause for the good men? Three good men. Step on up here, please. This is Brother Larry Williams, Brother Curly Williams, Brother Mo Williams. They have a tribute they'd like to make to someone in our church who has a strong fashion sense. And I told them, I said, you know, I think it'd be good for us to do that. So if you boys could just let us see your socks today. Can you step over here, please? We need the panoramic view. Higher, 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 higher. That's a kid's song. Isn't it? Be careful what you wear to church. Brandon, you should stand complimented today that someone thinks you have a strong fashion sense. And they did this to honor you. Do you feel honored today? You didn't, are you unworthy of this honor? Amen, you are. Amen. You just never know what's going to happen around here. We're going to be voting later on who has the best pair of socks. And you can vote either Mo, Larry, or Curly. And they will, yes, amen. So nevertheless, I must be on with my message. And that had nothing to do with what I'm going to preach. Is that all right? Is it all right to have fun while you're living for God? Now I can go all gloom and doom on y'all for about an hour and a half. Man, I could go all three shades of apocalypse. I can. I'm good at it, man. I could rip out the back of the Bible and we'll just go for 2 hours on. Or we can just go up to the front to the baguettes, man, and just bore y'all to death. How many of you know the devil's alive and well? Yeah.
We're not praising him, we're just acknowledging he's alive. How many of you know that he's always after us?
I mean, you know that he don't hardly ever sleep or slumber. He's a 24/7, 365, genuine good devil. He's a good devil. He knows his job and he's doing it. He ain't slacking on the job. You know, one of his greatest jobs is to make the child of God feel unworthy of being a child of God or being called a child of God or receiving the gift of God. So what he does like in more cartoons like you always used to see where they had a little angel on one shoulder, a little devil on the other shoulder, and a little devil, you know, always red, got pointed, like got horns, you got a little pointed tail and a pitchfork. And the angel's beautiful and just flies around white and got wings and everything. Y'all remember that cartoons like that? You know, and when a person in the scene is trying to do something good, you know, the angel's talking to them, telling them what they ought to do, how nice it ought to be. And then whenever something bad happens, that the little devil jumps up there and he starts talking to them. Y'all remember a cartoon like that at all? Am I just the only one old enough to remember cartoons that were still written down on paper? Yeah. We know that still goes on, but nobody wants to talk about it. Nobody wants to acknowledge it. Nobody wants to think about a little angel on one side, a little devil on the other side. As a matter of fact, everybody normally has a little angel in their pocket and just lets the devil sit on their shoulder. Oh boy, I had some fighting dogs one time and said, which one of them dogs wins the fight consistently? He said, the one I feed the most. He wins the fight. So the one you feed the most is going to win the fight. So which one of y'all going to get ready today and stop feeding the dog? I didn't come in here to mess around. I come in here to preach.
You got a drinking problem, you need to stay out of the bar. You got a drinking problem, you ought to let somebody else even go in the convenience store and buy you a soda water. Because you got to drive or walk by every drinking thing on earth to even get a soda water in them places. If you have trouble smoking, I don't care what you're smoking. Stay away from the smoking people. Whatever you feed yourself, that's what you become. You ever see anybody look like a hot dog? You ever see anybody look like a jumbo hot dog? With cheese? Chili? Onion? You ever see anybody look like a hamburger? All the time. There's enough people and enough things passing judgment on your life every day for you to pass judgment on yourself. Need to take it easy. Need to understand. Yo, the struggle is real. The devil's always there. He's always reminding me of the things I've done wrong, the things I didn't do right. He's always bringing the struggle ever to my door. You know what? So he's going to bring enough heat on you that you don't need to put any more heat on yourself. You need to just back up a little bit and say, you know what? If his grace is sufficient for me, if the Lord died and gave his life a ransom for me, if the blood of Calvary still covers me, you know what? I'm just going to run under the blood. I'm just going to hold on to God. I'm just going to hang on to the Jesus that I've got. I'm going to refrain and abstain from the things of this world, and I'm going to run under the umbrella of his provision and his covering. Let me tell you something. Just like there's a devil, there is a God. And God is real. And God's in the saving business. And you know what? He's so great a God, he said, there is no other God beside me. I'm going to tell you right now, there is more than one devil. You didn't hear me. I said, there is more than one devil because I have met his wife and his kids. You have too.
There's only one true and living God. There was an artist that has the distinction on earth of drawing the highest price ever paid for a work of art. We're going to show you that work of art today. It was the portrait of Dr. Gachet. That is the most highly valued painting that was ever sold at auction in the world. That don't look like much. Looks like a tired old man. It looks like the man who painted it must have been more tired than he was. Yet this painting brought $82.5 million.
Two other paintings of his are also among the top 10 highest paid in the world today. They are his self-portrait, which sold for $65 million, and the irises, which sold for $49 million. Who was this enigmatic artist? An extremely wealthy man? An artist recognized and appreciated as an artistic giant? Actually, not at all. The artist was Vincent van Gogh. And although his paintings sell for tens of millions today, they barely sold for a few dollars back in Van Gogh's lifetime. In fact, of his 900 paintings and 1,100 drawings, only a handful sold during his lifetime at all. Van Gogh spent most of his adult life in poverty and obscurity and was completely unappreciated for his genius. Combined with his chronic depression, Vincent van Gogh had the inability to find financial success or recognition as an artist that brought him to the point of despair. On July 29, 1890, at the age of 37, with his best works still in his mind, in his heart, Vincent van Gogh took his own life. What seemed like to be a failure of a man is touted one of the greatest artists who ever lived. Even to our dying day, we must withhold judgment on our own lives because we will have a gallery of judges all around us. Can somebody say amen? Don't judge yourself too hard. Don't be too hard on yourself. And then turn to somebody next to you and say, hey, don't be too hard on me.
Is there anybody who would like to get up and go to somebody in the church and say that same thing right now? We'll wait. Everybody's looking around.
Who's going to go now? No one but God knows the ultimate effect that your life and my life is going to have on someone else in the future. Marvin, I'm going to tell you right now, no one could have known that Brandon's socks would have made as strong an impression on the Williamses as they did. It was so strong that they took money out of their own pocket, drove to Walmart. Now you know where Brandon gets his socks. And bought them each a pair of fabulous designer socks. Put them on as a combined effort to show solidarity of spirit and how much they believe in Brandon. Had enough of whatever it is to come up here and lift their britches leg about 6 inches and let you see them colored things. So let me tell you something. Think about that. Don't sell yourself short. You're having an impact on somebody and you don't even know it. Amen. Y'all don't know whether to laugh or think I'm cutting up or whether that's for real, do you? Van Gogh never understood the true effect that he had or that his work had on the art world or on people. He certainly never saw that his paintings would sell for more money than any other paintings on the history of the face of the earth. He had no idea that his impressionist art would take over and entire edifices and museums around the world would be dedicated to his type of work of impressionism. He left a strong impression on the world around him, not while he was here, but far after he was gone. So I would ask you this, has God instilled something in your life, a particular talent, Brother Billy, a trait, or something that you do, or something that we bring to the table? So whether it's on purpose or inadvertently, is there something that we say? Is there a way we carry ourselves? Is there a way we greet other people? Is there a way we encourage somebody else? Is there a way that you write an email, a card, or a letter? Is there a way that you send somebody a text? Is there a way that you live the life for Christ before them that would make them want to be like you someday? And even long after you're gone, they say, in times like this, I remember Brother Knight. I remember how he used to worship. I remember without fetters how he would shout before the Lord. Is there somebody here today that's going to live a life that anybody would ever remember and say, I can remember that lady, how she prayed in the prayer room. I can remember her voice. enemies, Philistines. Probably had no idea that by his death he won a more stirring victory than any other time in his life. And Samson had slain that man some Philistines in his day. Greater than any of the victories he had during his life, describes a victory in Judges chapter 16 of where a lad of a boy led him to the pillars of the temple filled with Philistine enemies. And he prayed, "Father, forgive me. But give me the strength I once had just one more time, and I'll defeat the enemies in your name." You know, there comes a time, regardless of what we've been through, regardless of where we've been, that when we come to this fact that, Lord, I may have stumbled, I may have failed, I may not have always done what's right. Lord, if you'll create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within me, we may do greater things in the end than we ever did at the start. Is anybody here that, you know, maybe it's been a long time since you had your spiritual batteries charged. Maybe it's been a long time since you had a spiritual renewal. Maybe you don't even know you need spiritual renewal. You know, that's like needing to know, like whether you know whether or not you need a bath. You know, you might not ever recognize it, but everybody around you knows you do.
You might not even recognize you need a spiritual renaissance. Maybe it's just the way you
look at people when they say something. Maybe it's just the way you turn your back. Stomp off when people say something. Maybe it's just the way you ignore people. Maybe it's the way you talk about people. Ain't nobody talk about nobody here, but I would talk about it if you did.
Right?
Sure.
I can't even look around now.
I'm just here to ask you a few questions.
We've been talking about how good God is, marching seven times around, shouting, getting our victory, getting all this. But is it making any impact on our life? And is that impact trickling down to where it makes an impact on anybody else? Are you doing anything worthy of following? Are you going anywhere anybody want to follow you? Are you doing anything that people want to emulate you? Has anybody got any hope in you? Got any faith in you? Are you doing anything with giving anybody to have faith? I just got to ask the question, Brother Martin. That's what God called me to do today. I'm probably going to ask more questions than I'm going to make affirmative statements today. Samson made a mistake. Fell asleep in the lap of the enemy. Told the enemy exactly where to attack him. You've heard me say it a dozen times. You know what? The enemy generally don't have any intel on us other than that which we give him. I preached about it before. I'm going to preach about it again because you know what? You don't hear Amazing Grace one time just quit singing it.
Amen.
Boy, if that brother does that one more time to me, I'll tell you right now, brother, if he says that one more, if he turns his back, if he don't shake my hand, if well, if she walks right by me one more time and doesn't pay me the time of day, all you're doing is telling the devil right to where to attack you, right what he needs to do for you to fly off and get crazy. For you to ruin anything good God's ever done in your life. Do you know you can mess up a whole lifetime of good by one stupid thing? You can flip out and go off on somebody at church or something, say an ugly word or whatever, and destroy 79 years of trying to do right. We tell them right where to attack us. I can't make it one more day. If I'm sick tomorrow, I'm just going to throw in the towel. Guess what, honey? He's going to make you sick.
You will be sick tomorrow.
That's the truth.
I promise. God might even let you be sick tomorrow just to see if you that stupid.
You'll trust
me. The devil may say, I'm... And the Lord said, I'm going to let you be sick one more day just to see if you that dumb. Because the Bible said, faith without works is dead. And without faith, it's impossible to please God. Well, that we first must believe that he is, that he even exists,
And that he is a rewarder of them that do what? Diligently seek after him. You living a life anybody wants to live with you? You walking the walk, talking the talk, you doing what you need to do to get it done? The Apostle Paul must have looked like a grave failure in the Bible, wrote most of the epistles, wrote most of the New Testament. Languished for 2 years in a jail, and finally they killed him. Little did he know, 2,000 years later, the letters he wrote would be among the best-selling book in the world, read by billions of people worldwide. The words he said would have an impact on generation upon generation upon generation upon generation. And we might think that he stumbled and fell toward the end and God wasn't with him. But I just see that Paul's life, that when the Lord decided to take Paul on home, it was just a shortcut to glory. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
Paul says in 2 Corinthians, and I'm going to get down to the end of this right here pretty quick. Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 2, he said, we are epistles. That means we are letters known and read of all men. Now, some of our letters are real long. Some are real short. Some of them are intriguing and exciting, and some of them just as boring as all get out. Some of our lives are filled with many events, and some of our lives are uneventful at all. Some of our lives read like a Greek tragedy. Some of our lives read like a Roman triumph. Some of the story of our lives read like a great novel that anyone would be engaged to be involved with. And then other stories in our life are lackluster. Nevertheless, we all have our story and we all have a letter. The Bible says that our lives are like letters known and read of all men. Have you ever wondered if you was a little fly on the wall, what would be said about you when you're gone?
I want to think about that for a minute, because while we're alive, we never think about it. When we're dead, we don't know we're thinking about it. It's too late. What will be said of you when you're gone? I'd just like to poll the audience. Does anybody would like to stand and say right now what they think would be said of you when you are gone? That's okay. Go ahead. Anybody? Not one.
Did you ever wonder how you'd be remembered? Brother Ted, you wonder how you're going to be remembered. Well, first of all, you're going to be remembered as a giant. But then you're going to be remembered for being a gentle giant and having a sweet spirit and loving people. You'll be remembered for that. Okay, now listen. This is all something we think about, but we don't go there. We don't go there. We talked about the influence we have in life, but what kind of influence do we really have? I'm slowing way down because I'm fixing to kick this thing into overdrive, Mr. Cherry. I'm going to get around what I come to say. Do you want to be known for being the wishy-washiest person you ever saw in your life? Do you want to be known for being the moodiest person you ever saw in your life? Do you want to be known for being the most ornery person you ever saw in your life? Do you want to be known for being the most foul-mouthed person you ever saw in your life? Well, last time I checked, the way you're going to be remembered is the way you are right now.
Because if the Lord were to come, are you a little ticker stop ticking? You ain't got no more time to straighten up, fly right. You ain't got no more time to change. Okay. So your track record is everything you were before you got here today. That's how we're going to be remembered. Right. Woo, now some of us are excited. And some of us in deep, dark depression right now. Some of us are saying, woo, maybe there's room for me to straighten up and fly right. I need to change. You know what? Those people who are in said the I need to change crowd need to be excited about the fact that if you still got a breath in your body and the coming of the Lord is at hand, but he ain't come yet, there's still time to change.
You say, well, I'm a flawed character. Well, join the crowd. We all got flaws. On the pages of my life, there are written many mistakes, Sister Poe. Lots of mistakes. A lot of things I should have done. You know what? But I will tell you this. Flaws in our lives or our character do not detract from the value. I said they do not detract from the value to God, his kingdom, or the world around us just because you have a flaw.
There's not one perfect person in here. And I think I'm fair enough judge to say that. The fact that I'm judging you means that I'm imperfect as well. Amen? Thought there for a minute, you know, I'm qualifying my judgment. No, I'm just trying to tell you that by judging other people, I got to step down from the path of perfection myself. Isaiah chapter 1 verse 8 said, come now, let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. And though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool.
Aren't you thankful that there's a safety net, that there is hope? Aren't you thankful it doesn't matter how you are right now, there's still time to change? Aren't you glad that regardless of what you might have been remembered for in the past, that the chapter of your future hasn't been written because the pen still remains in the author's hand? Because Jesus said he is the author and the finisher of our faith. All you've got to do is have a little faith to get up and get beyond the circumstance that you find yourself in today. Today might not be your best day. You might not be having the best day of your life. Let me tell you something. If the Lord tarries and if the sun comes up tomorrow, he's going to give you the gift of another brand new day. And what you do with this day is up to you. And what you do with every tomorrow that you have till the day you die is up to you. So you still have the power to come to God, and you have the power to enact change. The hardest, most valuable, most beautiful stone in the world is a diamond. Diamonds are formed by heat and pressure from the shifting and colliding of the earth's subterranean layers as the earth's crust. Diamonds are most readily validated or identified not by their clarity, but by their flaws. If you went to a gemologist with a very beautiful, valuable diamond, the first thing they would do is put that diamond under high intensity magnification. Then they would draw what is called a gem map, G-E-M-M-A-P. And they would chronicle, said to Angie, the feathers, the flaws, and the inclusions in this stone of great value, and they would place them on a gem map, an exploded map of the shape of your stone, showing where every flaw in that stone might be. This does not devaluate the stone, but lends an incredible amount of value to the fact that you do not have a fake stone. But the fact that your stone is flawed makes it quite authentic and real. Isn't it something that diamonds are formed under heat and pressure? Anybody relate to heat and pressure? There's an old song years ago. I'm full of old songs. My wife says I'm full of baloney. No bluegrass song. I don't think I can sing it. I said, I'm just an old chunk of coal, but I'm gonna be a diamond someday. I'll spare you the rest. My best bluegrass impersonation. Dueling banjos or something in the background. I'm just an old chunk of coal.
every diamond starts out very humble. Every diamond starts out as being something of little or no value. But the value is lent to every diamond by the amount of heat that you put to, the amount of pressure that you've lived under. And when you survived enough heat and you survived enough pressure, the Bible says the Lord presents unto himself a diamond. A diamond. That we are brought through the furnace. The Bible says, refined, like the maker's fire. That we're refined by those things. Heaven is comprising a heavenly resume on you and I while we live. Our true value to God and to others will never be known until our lives are finished. But while we yet live. While we yet live. The last time I checked, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9 and 10, Justin says this, but we are a chosen generation. For that we ought to be thankful. We're a royal priesthood. That's what the Bible says we are, Brother Carney. We're a holy nation. Boy, it just keeps getting better and better and better. He says, then a peculiar people. That doesn't mean a crazy bunch of folks. That means a hand-picked bunch of people. We're peculiar just to God. Hand-picked by the Lord. That we should what? Show forth the praises of him that's called us out of darkness and to his marvelous light. That's where we are now. Thank God we're not walking in darkness. Thank God we're no longer children of the darkness. Thank God we're not lured by the darkness. But we are brought in by his grace, his mercy, his power, his deliverance into the light. So we now are the children of the light. I love this part. Verse 10. Which in times past were not a people.
In times past, we were not a people. We were scattered. We didn't have any hope. There was no place for us to go without the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ and salvation's message, the ability of the Holy Spirit. We had no hope. And Paul went on to say, even after receiving the gift of God, if I had hope in this world only, I would be of all men most miserable. But my hope is not in the Lord. My hope is in the Lord. My hope is not in the things of this world. I don't put my stock in real estate, put my stock in the finances, put my stock in every other aspect of life more than I put my stock in God.
Well, I don't know how that affects you, which in times past were not a people, but are now the people of God. But are now the people of God. The last time I checked, we're a child of God. We need to walk like a child of God. And if we're a child of God, says, we need to talk like a child of God. Who walks like a duck, quacks like a duck, looks like a duck, is a duck. Walks like a Christian, talks like a Christian, acts like a Christian, has faith like a Christian. Man, we ought to be easily identified on this, in this world as being a child of God. And somebody say, amen. Who in times past were not a people, but now the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy.
Now, if you ain't got nothing else all week to be happy about, we were not a people before, but now we are a people who had no mercy before, but now we're brought into this great church by the mercy of God. You know what? We ought to applaud God for these very things.
I just need somebody to preach 5 more minutes and I'm done. 5 minutes. Y'all ready? I got anybody going to preach with me 5 minutes. Just raise your hand. I want to see who you're going to be. Who you are. You going to preach 5 minutes with Pastor. 1 Samuel chapter 30, verse 6. The enemy had come and burned down the city of David, the city of Ziklag, had been burned with fire. The women and children were taken into captivity, and all that were in the city were spoiled. And David was the commander of the troops that had led his men out into a fight, and the enemy doubled back on him, come and burned the city after his own name, the city of Ziklag. After the city was burned, said that after they were through with their battle, though, with the enemy, they came back, and their own city had been burned. Their own house had been pilfered. Everything they had was taken. All the goods, all the sheep, all the women, all the children, everything had been held in captivity. Everything was gone. The men rose up against the leader and sought to stone David. And David was at the lowest ebb of his life. There's somebody here today, you faced hardships before, you faced trials before, you faced tragic times before, and you felt like maybe this might be the most difficult thing that you've ever faced in your life. It was in that difficult time that David had to draw upon the reserves when he wrote such scripture as, "Let everything that hath breath praise ye the Lord." And when he wrote such scriptures as, "I will enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise." And then when he wrote such scriptures as, "I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord." He had to draw way deep down on the reserves that he had somewhere in his relationship with God before this discouraging time, and he had to rise to meet the challenge. How did he do it? The scripture says right here in 1 Samuel chapter 30 verse 6 that David encouraged himself in the Lord.
When I was learning how to preach, I would go and stand in front of the mirror, and I'd preach my whole message to myself in front of the mirror so I could see if I could convince myself that what I was saying was good. I did it many times, and it's the funniest looking thing you ever saw in your life. I'd stand there and I'd figure out how I was going to stand. Then I'd stand there and figure out, you know, what I was going to do with my Bible, my tithe. I figure out how I wanted to hold the microphone, if I wanted to choke right down on, look at the thing, preacher, do some kind of, or if I wanted to, you know, have a pinky out. Ready?
Have my pinky out. I look, you know, hey, I don't want to look stupid. I probably still look stupid, but I don't want to. I don't choose to look like a dummy. I get up there, I'm looking at that dress, and I preach myself. You know, because I want it to be perceived. I want it to be received. I wanted people to believe what I said because it was believable. I wanted to have the right posture. I wanted to do what was right. You know, and then what happened when whenever I come home and I didn't do too good, like I'm doing today. Listen now. I'd have to go home and look in that same mirror, Brother Bruce. And I'd have to say, what happened? What did you do? Did they get any of that at all? Do they even know what you're talking about? Were you speaking clearly? Were you just a dummy? And you look in that mirror, and you answer those questions, and you're honest with yourself, well, you preach a much better message next time. You know, once in a while, we need to look in the mirror. Come on now. The last time I checked, I'm still the same man I was. The last time I checked, I'm still the same woman I was when I had victory 3 weeks ago. Now, this trouble has come. The sickness has come. This hardship has come. But you know what? I'm not going to let it change me from the man that I once was. I'm not going to let it change me from the woman that God has saved and that he put upon a solid rock and a firm foundation and put a song in my heart. I'm not going to let it change me. I might not look what I see right now. I might not like what I see right now, the way I look right now, but I'm going to encourage myself. I'm going to get back up. I'm going to start doing a good work for God. I'm going to start believing what I have believed all my life, regardless of the temporary storm that I'm in today. There are people that go through tragic situations. They go through difficult times. They go through storms in their life. And during that storm, and when times are harder than they've ever been, they think now's the time I need to make a decision on which way I'm going to go or what kind of direction I've got for my life. No, honey, don't you ever make a permanent decision during a temporary storm. The last time I checked, the storms don't decide how long they stay, because God steps on board the vessel and says, "Peace be still." And with three words, your situation can change in a split second. Somewhere along the way, David said, "I may be down, but I'm not out. My city might be burned down, but we're going to rebuild it bigger and better than we've ever built it before. And from the ashes, the Bible said, I will give you beauty for ashes." I may have flaws. Somebody needs to look look the devil right in the eye and say, I might have flaws, but the last time I checked, even the most valuable diamonds in the Smithsonian Institution have a flaw. And there's a drawer that you can go and pull the gem map and see where the flaws are in that stone. And because it has a flaw, makes it so valuable that it's placed in a museum that nobody can touch it. Last time I checked, I might be tired, but I have not turned back. The last time I checked, I might feel lost every once in a while. But I will tell you what, God knows the way. God knows the way. I said there are times I might just feel lost. Times I might not feel like I don't have direction. And I'm going to tell you what, it doesn't matter. The most confident individual in this congregation from time to time feels like they don't have direction. They don't have a true sense of direction. You know what? I'm like this before. I got hit in PE one time by a bully. Hit me right around the end of the nose and knocked me flat down on the ground. And for the first 5 minutes, all I saw was stars. I couldn't see nothing else. It reminded me of that scripture in the Bible when it said, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven. A guy hit me three ways, quick, fast, and in a hurry. And the fourth way was continuously. And Brother Billy, all I could see was stars. I didn't know where to strike back. You know, sometimes you get hit so hard, all you can see is stars. The smartest thing you can do is do like they say, when a bear comes, just play dead.
Make them think they done killed you. Don't keep swinging. Don't try to get up in there on them. Stay there a minute, figure out your strategy, what you're going to do next. Lord, I hope he quits here in a minute. He's about to kill me. Lord, I hope that bear, I know he eat my foot, but at least he started at my foot, not at my head. Help me be patient, God. Unless he gets up around my knee, I'm going to sit here. Last time I checked, I could still walk with a prosthesis. Yeah. Hang in there. Yeah. Amen. Amen. I might be sick, but the last time I checked, he's the great physician. Yeah. I might not be perfect, but perfection is not a state of being as much as a process of becoming. And there's not one perfect save the Lord. And I strive to be like him. But the last time I checked, he alone is perfect. He alone is the object of my worship. He alone is to be praised. He alone will receive glory. Can somebody say amen? I might have some scars, and I talked about it last week, but every time I look at those scars, I'm reminded of a healer who healed that scar in my life. And I don't remember the pain, but I remember the fact that he loved me enough to heal that situation in my life. And I carry that scar that I might give him thanks for a healing. The road may be long, but the last time I checked, I'm still on the road, and somebody needs to give God glory for that. I said, this road may be long, but the last time I checked, I'm still on the road. I said, I'm still on the road. I may be weak, but the Bible says that in my weakness, Joe, he is made strong. God's not depending on you to be strong all the time. He's depending on you to depend on his strength. You know what? If you're so strong, you wouldn't need God. But I'll tell you right now, the strongest decision you ever made in your life is to let God have your weakness, because in our weakness, he is strong. Don't bring God all your strength. Don't bring God all your power. Why don't you come to God when you're powerless? Why don't you come to God when you're weak? Why don't you come to God when you ain't got nothing left? And he said, I will supply all your needs according to my riches and glory. You ain't waiting on yourself to get to heaven. I'm waiting on God to take us there. I'll tell you right now, I may live a whole lifetime, Sister McLean, and my life, my name might not ever be worth a nickel. I can live a whole lifetime trying to do good, and my name might not ever turn any heads. Brother Ted, but the Bible says, when I went down in that baptistry up here, that he has given me a name that's above every name, that at the name of Jesus, all hell trembles. You might not know my name. You might not ever know my name, but I pray that once you've been around me very long, you will know the God that I serve, and you will know his name. I may be troubled on every side, but the last time I checked, the Bible said he's an ever-present help
in the time of trouble. I may have been bound by things in my life or in this world, but the Lord is my rock. He is my salvation. And the Bible says the angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear him, and he delivereth them. You don't have to leave here bound anymore. You might be tossed by every wind of doctrine, but let me tell you something. God has given us a truth that is secure. It's an anchor of our faith. It is that thing which will take you from earth to glory. And I will tell you, in the end, I may be knocked down, but I am never out of the fight. Would you stand? I said, I might get knocked down, but I ain't never out of the fight. Bible says, rejoice not against me, O mine enemy. When I fall, I shall arise. I may get knocked down, Joe, once in a while, but I ain't never out of it. I ain't never out of it. Somebody needs to affirm in your faith to the Lord, you know what, I may get knocked down once in a while, but Lord, I ain't never out of it. I'm with you. I'm going to march with you. I'm going to go with you. I'm going to be obedient to your voice. I'm going to say yes to what you want me to do. I'm going to go where you have me go. I'm going to say, I'm going to be obedient, God, in the call of God on my life. I'm going to be obedient to answer that call and say, yes, here am I, Lord, send me. Let me tell you something. We're all leading somebody somewhere, just where we lead them. The last time I checked, our lives are the only Bible some people read. Are you hearing, Pastor, today? I'm just trying to drive a nail in something we've been talking about for a month now. I'm preaching anything new to you today. If somebody was to hitch their wagon to you right now, which way would you lead them? Well, Mom, I'm confident in which way you would lead. If you said, okay, I'm going to become best friends with that person. I will become best friends with that person. And I'm going to trust where they lead me. I know where to put my trust. I know where to put my trust. Are you going to live a life that people can follow you to the foot of the cross? Are you going to live a life that people are going to follow you somewhere else? Because the last time I checked, there is no hope unless we find it at the foot of the cross. I said, the last time I checked, there is no hope save Jesus Christ and him crucified, risen, and coming again. Amen. Would you close your eyes with me for just a minute? Now, I said a lot, but the reason I'm asking right now is God just wants you to think about yourself for a second. Think about yourself. I preached a lot of different things today. But the whole rhetorical thread of everything that I'm preaching comes back to this. Who are we? What are we? And what are we going to do about what we become right here, right now? Sometimes a ministry of exhortation demands that we respond on exactly how we feel at that moment. Somebody here is so weary and so tired. Man, you've been going through it so bad. You don't even have the strength to come down front and to even affirm what I preached today. But that's all right. You don't have to have the strength to come down. All you have to do is just say, Lord, Brother Hudson said, in my weakness, you are strong. So I'm going to give you all I have left is weakness. Is anybody here would just raise your hand? Nobody looking around. I'm just going to give you my weakness now. I don't have a lot of strength. I don't have a lot of flashy stuff I can give you, Lord. I'm just going to give my weakness now. I'm going to give my weakness. Now, Lord, I got talent and ability, and I know that that isn't anything that I created on my own. But now, Lord, it's an ability that's God-given. Some people have even said, you have a God-given talent. Somebody standing on the sound of my voice, somebody has even said it to you before, you have a God-given talent. Ma'am, God-given talent, sir. I want to know if you would just lift your hand now and say, I'm going to commit my God-given talent to the Lord. Come on, this is a ministry of exhortation. It's different than just a salvation message. It's just, y'all gonna give that God-given talent to the Lord. There you go. There you go. The Lord, everything, now here's a segment of people that everything's going good. Everything looks fine. Everything looks all right. Got a good job, live in a nice house. If you want to be married, you're married. If you don't want to be married, and you're single and you're happy, praise the Lord. But everything's going good. But in all of that, are you willing, even when times are good, are you willing to be subservient unto the Lord? I always find it's a lot easier to pray when I'm in trouble. I always find it's a lot easier to touch God when I'm broke and when I'm in a bind. But you know, every time things start looking good, everything starts flying right, that job comes through, the money comes through, the promotion comes through, then sometimes we even forget that where we got from where we are to where we are today. So I'm going to ask you, everything that's going good, all the successes, I'm going to ask you now, would you just give that to the Lord? Is there anybody that would give that to God right now? Raise your hand. I'm going to raise mine. The Lord's been so good to me, but it is nothing I've done. It's nothing I deserve. Resigning to the Lord. I'm going to ask this one more time before we go. I want you, if you just really want to give God something today, just lift your hands with me. That's just the simplest faith, simplest act of faith I know. Say, okay, Lord, I'm going to give it to you. Right now, the thing that I struggle with, God, the thing that I'm battling with right now, I lift my hands to you. I resign that to you. I give that over to you. I trust you with it. Lord, you know, I have wrestled it. Lord, I have spoken to it by faith. I have lived a life trying to please you. But I will tell you now, God, in the midst of the struggle, in the times that I don't know which way to go, you said that you are the way, the truth, and the life. So therefore, I resign it. I give it over to you. I hand it to you by faith. And I say, now, Lord, I can't take it. I can't carry it any longer. Lord, I can't shoulder this load anymore. God, I give it to you. I resign that to you. I lay that on you because your shoulders are broad. Your arm is not short. I'm going to give that over to you, God. I'm not carrying it out to the car. I'm going to leave it in this church house under the blood of Jesus Christ. I'm going to rise up and be blessed from this moment forward. I'm going to go out of here blessed. I'm going to go out of here healed. I'm going to go out of here renewed. I'm going to go out of here with a touch from God on my life. I don't plan to go back out to the car the way I came in this house.
Thank you.
Last time I checked, the Bible said the heavens are his throne and the earth is his footstool. So the heavens are his throne. The earth is his footstool. We serve a great, big, mighty God. He's has all power in heaven and earth. And here's what his word said. He said, if you draw close to me, I'm going to draw close to you. You take one step, Sister Sermon, toward me, I'm going to take a step towards you. Look at me just 1 minute, everybody in the church, for just a second. I know I ain't much to look at, but just look at what I'm about to show you. I'm an average height man. I don't have real long, athletic legs. My stride, if I was to have to run, Sister Bradley, it'd only be if somebody was chasing me. If I had to run, my stride's about 3 foot. For each stride. Now, Joe, I don't have your stride. You got about 6 foot stride. I got about 3 foot stride. That's why I'll never be you. And you're thanking God you will probably never be me. 3 foot stride ain't much. But listen to this, man. Now, Justin, the Bible said if we take a step toward the Lord, that wasn't very hard, was it? Wasn't very far, was it? Amen. Adrian, I took that step. I took the first step. I'm going to plant a little seed on y'all today. You can go home with it. The Lord said, draw nine to me, I'll draw nine to you. Well, Shane, I took the first step. Y'all seen me. It was about about what I'm able to do. But now, Coach, the Bible said the heaven is his throne and the earth is his footstool. So how big is God? Pretty big. Right? Tom, you might know this. How many miles is it to the moon? You have any idea? I figured you'd know that. Can we find that out? How many miles to the moon? They're working on it right now. Now let's say the Lord's up, you know, his head's about up there at the moon and his foot down here on the earth. He's pretty big. I need to be prepared for these illustrations early, Brother Billy. I'm sorry. I should have wrote that down. The Lord just laid it on my heart now. The distance to the moon is, you got it, Brother Brandon? About 225,117 miles, give or take a few miles. 225,000 miles. Well, let's see here. The Lord's 225,000 miles tall. That's going to make his legs about 100,000 miles long. So you do all you can do, and then the Lord, with his 100,000 mile long leg, you take a step toward him. One step. I want everybody to know that God ain't got no 12-step program. He got a one-step program. You take one step, and then the Lord said he's going to take a step towards you. Now, I think he got you covered on that. You just draw nigh to him, and he said he would draw nigh to you. That ain't that hard. You ain't got to come down here sniveling, bawling, screaming, and crying to get what you need from God. Contrary to popular belief, there are other ways to get what you need from the Lord. You just got to have a little faith. And when you come to church, you got to believe what's being preached, because we didn't do nothing but just preaching the Word of God. So the thing is, when you need God, you just take the first step, and the Lord said, I'll take the rest. Amen. I come to encourage you today. It's a ministry of exhortation. That's what I come to do. You don't have to do much. Just do what you're able to do, and God will do the rest. It's a one-step program. Church, I love you. I feel the blessings of the Lord. I feel like somebody here is giving God something they need to give the Lord now because they couldn't carry it the rest of the week. So, hey, listen, we're going to trust the Lord, and we're going to take a step toward God just this week. I want somebody to take, even if you got to take a baby step of faith just this week, take one step. Prove God. He said, prove me now if I would not open to you the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing on you that there shall not be room enough to receive. Take one step in the right direction. God's going to do the rest. Can we just thank the Lord right now? Lord, I love you. I'm glad to be in your house today. I ask that you would anoint and bless this congregation under the sound of my voice. Lord, this week I'm going to be challenged to sit down, sit back, go backward, but I'm going to take and make a step forward in Jesus' name. I'm going to take the right step to do the right thing, and I'm going to grow in you. I'm going to have a spiritual renaissance in my life. There's going to be a turnaround in my life. There's going to be a turnaround in my spirit, a turnaround in my attitude. Lord, create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within me. In Jesus' name we pray.